Shabbat shalom. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I will fear no evil, for you are with me, and your rod and your staff, they comfort me. This is what David says in Psalm 23, verse 4. David writes about Jesus, the ruler's rod, the authority and power against his enemies. The rod of the ruler in Hebrew is Shevat, the month of the good news, the 11th month of the biblical calendar, found in the book of Zechariah. So what happened in the month of Shevat that made this month the month of good news? Four important days occurred this month, and they all speak of fruit and abundance. First, Antiochus V, one of Israel's ancient rulers, abandoned his plans to destroy Jerusalem. Second, Zechariah received a vision that foretold the future restoration of the two houses of Israel, the menorah, flanked on each side by two olive trees. Third, on Shevat 1, Moses began his Torah teachings to the Jewish people. Fourth, the 15th day of Shevat, called To Be Shevat, is an important Jewish holiday, the new year of trees, the Jewish Earth Day. We previously made a detailed video about Shevat called the Hebrew month of Shevat. The Hebrew letter associated with Shevat is the 18th letter of the Hebrew alphabet called Tzadik. And the shape of Tzadik symbolizes a tree, the tree of life, in the Garden of Eden. Today I want to take a closer look at this tree. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from its fruit, and she ate. And she gave also to her husband with her, and he ate. This is the famous Bible verse about the fall of man, where Eve is deceived by Satan. Note that trees are symbols of human beings in the Bible. The Bible teaches us again and again about trees that may or may not bear fruit, which is directly connected to our salvation, resurrection. Eve saw that the tree was good for food, which was completely new to her. She did not ask the Father for advice, she just ate. But how did she eat? I'm not sure about you, but when I eat something new, something I'm not familiar with, I taste it very carefully. Step by step and bite by bite. But this is not what Eve did. The word used here for ate is akal, or la'at in Hebrew, translated as devour, to eat without thinking, to eat as animals do. Esau said to Jacob, "Please, let me have a swallow of that red stuff, I am famished." Esau says here, "Feed me," which is the same Hebrew word as eat like an animal, devour. Eating like an animal means eating without careful consideration. And this is what Eve and Esau did. Eve lost her salvation, and Esau lost his inheritance, because they slept, their eyes were not open. Eve's eyes only opened when she ate the fruit. She had no idea that she was being deceived. There's a beautiful parallel to this in the book of Revelation. "Because you say I am rich and have become wealthy and have need of nothing, but you do not know that you are wretched, miserable and poor, and blind and naked." This is what many people today think, that they are fully clothed, covered in the blood of Jesus. But in reality, they are blind and naked like Eve, being deceived. Jesus said four times during the Olivet Discourse that we will be all deceived in the end. And the great dragon was thrown down, the serpent of old, who is called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. It all started with Satan in the Garden of Eden, as an example to all of us. These things took place as example for us, that we might not desire evil as they did. Did God really say, "You shall not eat from any tree in the garden"? Did God really say, "His feasts are Jewish feasts"? Did God really say, "Replace my feasts for Christmas and Easter"? Did God really say, forget Shabbat and replace it with Sunday? No, he didn't. God does not lie to us. The enemy does. The enemy deceives. Adam and Eve did what many people do today. They listened to the serpent instead of the Father. That's hard to hear, right? But unfortunately true. Listening to the world instead of following God involves nakedness, which is quite serious in the Bible. Your nakedness will be uncovered. Your shame also will be exposed. And I will take vengeance, and I will not spare a man. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat? The tree here is the Hebrew word Hamin, which is spelled the same as Haman, the evil guy in the story of Esther, a descendant of Amalek who wanted to destroy the Jews. In other words, the story of Esther is directly related to the Garden of Eden. The energy of Haman, Satan, entered the world. Adam and Eve realized they were naked. And God kicked them out of the Garden of Eden, which was a big shock to them because they never thought the consequences would be so bad. So what does this mean for us today when we decide to follow man-made traditions instead of God's appointed times? And then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loin coverings. They sewed fig leaves to cover their nakedness. But we learn that fig leaves alone have no power. Scripture tells us that we need leaves and we need fruit. If we cover ourselves with fig leaves alone to cover our nakedness and do not bear fruit, Jesus will curse us. Seeing a fig tree by the road, he came to it and found nothing on it except leaves. And he said to it, no longer shall there ever be any fruit from you. And the fig tree withered. As mentioned, trees often represent people in scripture. Taking the blind man by the hand, he brought him out of the village, and after spitting on his eyes and laying his hands on him, he asked him, do you see anything? And he looked up and he said, I see men, for I see them like trees walking around. Jesus wants us to produce fruit, including leaves. Fruit represents food, and the leaves represents healing. Leaves are an image of good works. Every tree needs leaves to protect the fruit. Without the leaves, the fruit will be destroyed. Faith alone is not enough to bear fruit. If there's only work, but not fruit, no fruit, there is no life, which is why Jesus cursed the fig tree. Ezekiel teaches us all this when he speaks about the end times. By the river, on its bank, and on each side and the other, will grow all kinds of tree for food. Their leaves will not wither, and their fruit will not fail. They will bear fruit every month because their water flows from the sanctuary. Their fruit will be for food, and their leaves for healing. Jesus tells John the same thing in Revelation. In the middle of the street, on either side of the river was the tree of life, bearing 12 kinds of fruit, yielding its fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. But wait, we are all saved by the cross, right? We are all set free. So why we need to produce fruit? We are all under grace. Jesus does not say this. He says, I know them by their fruit. We will all ultimately be judged by our fruit. Indeed, the axe is already laid at the root of the tree, so every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. The word fruit appears 66 times in the New Testament. Every branch in me that does not bear fruit, he takes away. And every branch that bears fruit, he prunes it, so that it may bear more fruit. Pruning sounds logical, but we don't like the pruning process. Because maybe God is cutting something out of our lives that we are very attached to, which can be painful. But God only prunes it to produce more fruit. So surrender and let God the gardener do his work. In other words, embrace his pruning. God rewards us according to our fruit. So how to bear fruit and grow? To be teachable, to be changeable, to be servable, and to step out of our comfort zone. It started with the tree of life in the Garden of Eden, and it will end with the tree of life in the New Jerusalem. So who is this tree of life? Jesus. Jesus is the root, and Israel is the branches. I am the vine, and you are the branches. Jesus calls himself the first, the last, the Aleph, and the Tav. The tree of life is now in heaven, next to the Father, but where will he be? David gives us the answer. Then a shoot will spring from the stem of Jesse. A branch from his roots will bear fruit. Jesse was from the tribe of Judah, and he had a son named David. David, the shepherd, who became king of Israel. A foreshadowing of Jesus, the shepherd, who will become king of Israel when he returns. For the Lord has chosen Zion. He has desired it for its habitation. This is my resting place forever. Here I will dwell, for I have desired it. But as for me, I have installed my king upon Zion, my holy mountain. The tree of life is now in heavenly Jerusalem and will come down in the end of the millennium. The tree of life in Judaism represents an almond tree. In the Bible, it's all about trees, right? It's about fruit and leaves and trees. And he put a distance of 3 days journey between himself and Jacob. And Jacob fed the rest of Laban's flocks. And then Jacob took fresh rocks, a poplar, an almond, and plane trees, and peeled white stripes in them, exposing the white which was in the rocks. This is the well-known story about Jacob experiencing his three leaves. So where did Jacob experience this? In Bethel, meaning the house of God. And what was Bethel's name? In the past, Luz. And what does Luz mean? Elmond tree. Elmond tree. You've heard me say this many times. There are no coincidences in the Bible. Jacob experienced three leaves, all of which are about the resurrection. Scripture mentions 3 days, three trees, and the almond tree is a symbol of resurrection. Jacob's prophecy takes us to our end time resurrection. Either way, there's a reason why Bethel, the house of God, stands on the side of the almond tree. There's a reason why Aaron's rod, the budding almond rod, is in the Ark of the Covenant. The staff is the representation of God, his truth. There's a reason why God asked Moses to build the menorah like an almond tree. He asked Moses to start with a base, the center, and decorate it with 4 cups, 4 buds, and 4 flowers. A total of 12 decorations in the center. And then he had commanded Moses to add 3 branches to each side of the base, and decorate each branch with 3 decorations, a cup, a bud, and a flower. A total of 9 decorations per side. So in summary, we have 12 decorations in the center, we have 27 decorations on the left, and we have 27 decorations on the right, giving a total of 66. Could this represent, could this correspond to the 66 books of the Bible? I think it's possible. The central shaft is an image of Jesus. including the 12 tribes or 12 disciples. And there are 39 books in the Old Testament, representing by 27 on the left and 12 in the middle. And there are 27 books in the New Testament, 27 on the right, after the death or resurrection of Jesus. So why does the menorah represent the tree of life? Because the seven arms represent the 7 days of creation, including Shabbat. They represent God's seven feasts, the seven assemblies, God's seven spirits, his seven lampstands, the seven colors of the rainbow, and so on. The only way we can get to eternity, our salvation, is through the tree of life, menorah. The fig tree represents Israel in its disobedience. No fruit, which is why Jesus cursed the fig tree. Jesus saw a tree that indicated it would have fruit because of its leaves, but there was no fruit. And this is what we see happening today. Where believers believe they have fruit, but do not follow God's feasts, but the traditions of men. Unfortunately, many believers bear leaves but no fruit, and they are not aware of it. God gave Zechariah the vision of the menorah flanked by two olive trees, each on one side, representing both houses of Israel. Zechariah sees both houses restored because of the menorah, the tree of life, which proclaims God's appointed times, his feast, his Shabbat, his dress rehearsals. The tree of life is the wheat, the fig tree is the tares. No fruit means no salvation. Jesus is clear that we are the last generation, the one who sees Jesus in the clouds. So how can we know if we are the last generation? Jesus answered this question clearly to his disciples just before he was betrayed on the Mount of Olives. He said to them, "Learn the parable of the fig tree." And he told them a parable. "Look at the tree and all the trees. And as soon as they come out in leaf, you see for yourselves and know that the summer is already near. So also, when you see these things taking place, you know that the kingdom of God is near. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all has taken place." From the fig tree, learn its lesson. As soon as its branch becomes tender and puts out its leaves, you know that summer is near. So also, when you see all these things, you know that he is near at the very gates. Truly I say to you, this generation will not pass away until all these things take place. So what is this fig tree? Is it a symbol or an analogy? And what is summer? What is the summer? Let scripture interpret scripture and see what Hosea tells us. "Like grapes in the wilderness, I found Israel, like the first fruit on the fig tree. In its first season, I saw your fathers." Hosea tells us that the fig tree is Israel. Jeremiah tells us that the fig tree is Israel. And Jesus even speaks of it 3 times. To summarize, in the parable of the fig tree, Israel is the withering fig tree. And Jesus describes the tree coming back to life. So when did this happen? When did the fig tree Israel came back to life? On May 14, 1948, when Israel was reborn as a nation. It marked the beginning of the last generation, the current generation. But what does the term summer mean? Summer was near. The fig tree is one of the last to get its leaves in the spring. So when the plant starts to bloom, you know that summer is really near. And therefore, when the people of Israel saw all these signs or see all these signs, they will know that their redemption is near. In other words, this generation, the last generation, is the generation of 1948. But how long is a generation according to scripture? The days of our lives are 70 years and because of strength, 80 years. The years of our life are 70 or even by reason, by strength, 80. Yet their span is but toil and trouble. They are soon gone and we fly away. If we calculate 80 years, this could mean that Jesus will return in 2028. Is this the truth? Of course, we don't know for sure. But why take the risk? If we can help convince those around us that we are the last generation, that will most likely change their lives, right? And make sure that they are ready and have oil in their lamps. So what does this all mean for us today? Shavuot. First of all, to ensure that we are all rooted in the true soil of the Word, guided by the Holy Spirit. And when we do, we find life. We bear fruit. We stand firm against the adversary. The Messiah speaks in Matthew about the trees that bear no fruit. Think about ourselves for a moment. What kind of tree are we? Are we fruit, or are we just a beautiful flowering tree? Do we offer a shade roof? How deep are our roots, and how far do our branches extend? We should strive to be like a tree. Be well grounded. Connect with our roots. Turn over new leaves. Bow down and be humble. Enjoy our unique and natural beauty and be prepared to keep on growing. Shavuot is the time for this. To bring new life, to plant something new, a month of spiritual renewal. A new beginning, a new season, a new challenge, a new month. Have a blessed week. Shabbat Shalom.